Well, welcome back, everyone. Again, my name is John Baker. I'm a literary manager here at Woolly, and I'm moderating the second part of tonight, which is a town hall-style discussion. There we go. Which is a town hall-style discussion with some really wonderful folks on the topic of same-sex marriage. For those of you with smartphones, and for those of you who use Twitter, I'm going to say something that you very rarely hear in the theater. I would love you to turn your phone on. So take your iPhones out. Take your... What else do we will have? So take your phones out, and this is because this conversation is actually being live streamed on New Play TV, thanks to our friends over at Arena Stage. So thank you to our friends over there and the New Play Institute. So they have set us up tonight. So this is being live streamed, and that's what the camera over there is. And for those of you with Twitter, you can follow along and participate in the conversation using the hashtag right behind me, WoollyAid. So if you have questions and you get really antsy to get your questions out there, you can do that via Twitter, and I'm relying on Cameron over in the corner over here to follow along on Twitter, and any interesting questions that come up, he will raise them. So that's how that's going to work. So what I want to say is that I'm really one of the wonderful things about working at a theater in the nation's capital is that I'm up on stage with all of these amazing people who have done really amazing things, in relations to the same-sex marriage conversation. So what I'd like to do is just start off this part of the evening by having each of you guys introduce yourselves. And give us a sense, contextualize sort of where you fit into the same-sex marriage conversation. And that's how we'll start. And then after that, that'll give everybody out here a sense of your expertise and where you're coming from. We'll open it up to everybody for questions. So for anybody in the theater and anybody online using Twitter, we'll open it up. And that's how the evening's gonna work. So, without further ado, I'm going to pass the mic over and have you guys introduce yourselves.
Thanks, Tom. My name is Peter Rosenstein, and I'm the president of a group called the Campaign for All DC Families. What that is the organization that was put together predominantly to unite the groups in DC that were fighting for marriage equality. Back in 2005, there was a threat to have an initiative or referendum against same-sex marriage in D.C. And a couple of us sat down and put together a group called the Foundation for All D.C. Families to fight that if need be. We then turned that into a campaign, and that had to do with the political efficacy of doing a 501c4, which would allow us to lobby and raise money, which a C3 wouldn't. So many of us have been in this battle for a long time. And I think if you look at D.C., we were very fortunate, aside from having people like David and others on the council who moved this forward, but way back in 1977, with the Charter Amendment Act, we were lucky enough not to allow an initiative and referendum on marriage equality in D.C. So we didn't have to go through what Maryland and other states are going through. So many of us have been involved in this fight for a long time.
Thank you, Peter. I'm Ray Carey. I'm the executive director of the National Gay and Lesbian Task Force. We are based here in D.C., although have staff all over the country. We have been involved in a number of the ballot measures, all of the ballot measures really across the country having to do with marriage, including Prop 8. We helped run the field campaign for Prop 8, and then our colleagues in the legal organizations, you've seen their work up here tonight with the actors. I guess I actually want to make a personal connection to Prop 8, which is that my spouse, Margaret, and I are one of the 18,000 of those California married couples who married in the window, and we are actually married by the transgender man who argued the original case in front of the California Supreme Court to get marriage in California. So Prop 8, as it continues to play out, is in fact deeply personal, as well as how I and we, the task force, spend many of our days. One of the perspectives that we have had on marriage over time is to spend a lot of human and financial resources on marriage, but also to make sure that in the context of the humanity of our lives, that we continue to lift up the many other issues that are important to lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people in our families. Marriage is one of them, and others are as well. Any questions come up, I can speak to that. And the last thing I'll say before turning over to David is I was so struck by the timeliness of this and the time capsuleness of it. It was only a couple of years ago, and it is astonishing how much has happened in this country in that very short period of time, including the last month. And tomorrow, for those of you who didn't see it, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals will actually issue a decision on whether or not it will go for en banc and hear the case there or not. If not, then we certainly expect the opponents to push to bring it before the Supreme Court soon. So if we were having this tomorrow night, we might actually have a little bit of information.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is David Catania. I authored the marriage equality bill in the district. I want to point out that I was told that the dress would be casual. True story. I show up and this crowd would make coffee nervous. I mean, what it is. So I authored the bill that ultimately led to marriage equality in the district, but there's a lot of kind of fun sub-stories. And I'm watching this play itself out. This is not interesting, you know, in a funny ha-ha way, but it's interesting that we're living history. I made the decision to go forward with marriage equality shortly after President Obama was elected. I appreciated the fact that, you know, early in the term is the time in which big decisions can be made, that typically the incumbent president is going to lose. We didn't realize how much, but that there would be a reduction in congressional majorities if you had it, and so you wanted to strike early. And so I made the decision in November and December of 2008 that we would go forward. Hopefully we'll have a chance, if there's interest, in figuring out how we did that and the strategies that were being waived. Our first decision was to recognize marriages that were performed outside of the city as a camel's nose under the tent. And that was quite, a stroke of luck in how that came about. Ultimately, we had success here with marriage equality. People look at the city and say, well, you know, given the makeup of the council and support of the majority of the members, at least on paper, this should have been a cakewalk. But you know, there's often a divide between what people will say and what people do. And we have the misfortune of having been under the thumb of Congress, and so, you know, nothing that we do is easy. And that coupled with coming fresh off Prop 8, and I think the unfair blaming of African Americans for the defeat of marriage equality in Virginia, you know, having this decision and having this discussion in the majority African American community and ultimately prevailing, I thought was quite an exciting opportunity as a citizen of the city to watch. And so, you know, there are many, many great stories, some that are published and some that aren't. And depending on your interest, there are lots of fun unpublished stories that hopefully we can share tonight.
Hi, I'm Brian Moulton. I'm the legal director for Human Rights Campaign. HRC is the largest national LGBT advocacy organization here in D.C. and along with our partners in many organizations do work similar to what the task force does, engaging on with the state measures, including the Maryland campaign, New York, D.C., and others in recent years. What I do at HRC is actually on the federal level, working on federal policy questions, particularly around relationship recognition. We can't forget that aside from the state aspects of this, there are over 1,100 rights and benefits that come with marriage under federal law. And so I do a lot of work on trying to get rid of the Defense of Marriage Act, which prevents recognition of marriages for those purposes. And also, as David alluded to, there's a lot that Congress likes to do to meddle, not just with marriage equality in D.C., but to find creative ways, particularly under the current House of Representatives, to inject the issue of marriage equality into anything we try to do to address the range of rights that we're trying to achieve for this community, as Ray noted. So There's a strong federal dynamic to all of this work, and that's a lot of what I do at AFER. We've also been very happy to support the efforts of our litigation partners, including AFER and in the Prop 8 case as a friend of the court, and also to try and bring some unusual voices to these conversations in court, like the business community, pointing out why marriage equality is important for them to be able to be successful as well. So,
thanks, Brian. I'm Matt Nosanchuk, and I'm Senior Counsel to the Assistant Attorney General of the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice. And as I was sitting here, I was thinking about the fact that I joined the administration as a political appointee about 3 years ago, in June 2009. And in June 2009, I knew that I was going to be going to the Department of the Civil Rights Division to be part of that division's restoration transformation, and to be the person who was going to sort of oversee LGBT issues in the Civil Rights Division front office, a position which you may be surprised to hear wasn't held in the previous administration. So I was very excited to do that, and just about a few days before, everything was kind of public and confirmed. There was news in the blogosphere that the Department of Justice filed a brief in this case defending the Defense of Marriage Act that had what could fairly be described as incendiary language. It relied on arguments that had been made in the past by previous administrations defending Section 3 of the Defense of Marriage Act. And I had the good fortune at that time, in June of 2009, to be invited to the White House LGBT Pride reception that year. And I remember going to that reception and standing in line, and people were saying, well, what are you going to do? And I'm like, well, I'm going to the Department of Justice, because I was a little bit gun-shy at that point about shouting that and proclaiming from the rooftop, because the community was quite incensed, in retrospect, justifiably so. So, I went there, and subsequently, for lots of reasons, the briefs began to change. They continued to defend the Defense of Marriage Act, but using different arguments, different rationale. The president was on record saying that he believed the Defense of Marriage Act was discriminatory and should be repealed. And that was the environment in which I was working for the first part. And as I fast forward 3 years, it is nothing less than kind of mind-blowing the amount of change that has occurred. Because now, I've been invited to participate in this panel. What has changed? A couple of things. Well, the Department of Justice is no longer defending the Defense of Marriage Act. We're filing affirmative briefs arguing that, it is unconstitutional and that sexual orientation should be subjected to heightened scrutiny. Many of the arguments about immutability and political powerlessness that were discussed in the play tonight are those very arguments that, were discussed and adopted by the Justice Department in arguing to courts, as we have, that the Defense of Marriage Act is unconstitutional and should be subjected to heightened scrutiny. A week ago, the First Circuit in Boston struck the Defense of Marriage Act down, the first court of appeals to do so. A month ago, I think right during the very same week that I was invited to participate in this panel, someone down the street decided to announce his support for marriage equality, and that sort of changed the equation. And certainly for people working in the administration, has made it somewhat easier to appear on panels and discuss topics. And the department continues to actively litigate in the Defense of Marriage Act. And it's not the only issue relating to LGBT equality that I've worked on in the past few years when we passed the hate crimes bill, Matthew Shepard Dainsbury Jr. Hate Crimes Prevention Act, which HRC was very much involved in supporting. We testified in support of the Employment Non-Discrimination Act in 2009. And there have been multiple other advances on the executive branch front and then legislation that's been supported and not necessarily passed to otherwise further LGBT equality. So, the record is replete with a lot of accomplishments, a lot of forward advances. Of course, there's a lot more work left to do. But if someone told me 3 years ago that I'd be sitting on a panel here, talking about same-sex marriage and a president who supports it, Court of Appeals that struck down the Defense of Marriage Act, you know, the historic Proposition 8 case being tried and upheld on appeal, and now it looks like tomorrow we're going to have another, you know, step forward in that case. You know, I don't know that I would have necessarily believed you. So I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you. My name is Rich Madaleno, and from, I think, a line in the play, and to use a current term, I'm one of the 1%. And I am one of the 1% openly gay state legislators. I am the first openly gay person elected to the Maryland General Assembly, who ran as an openly gay person, was elected to the House of Delegates in 2002, and in 2006 I became the first and only openly gay person ever to serve in the Maryland State Senate. I'm a longtime fan of David Catania and Jim Graham, and have watched what they've carefully built over time in the District of Columbia, and we have steadily followed them a few steps behind, which sometimes happens. But we are now in a position where, after several years of me being the lead sponsor on the marriage equality bill, a nice guy by the name of Martin O'Malley, some of you may have heard of him, decided to take that bill from me and put it in this year, and we managed to pass it. And now Maryland faces, in essence, the same ballot measure that you saw today. In fact, one of the certainly most entertaining characters of the evening, Maggie Gallagher, is a real-life frightening person who is based in our area because they're in Northern Virginia, and she provided half the funds to put the our marriage law potentially on the ballot this year. Their first campaign finance report shows half their money came from the National Organization for Marriage. And if you want to know who they are, I think they're now officially a registered hate group, a characterized hate group by the Southern Poverty Law Center. HRC has put out a website, I think it's called nonexposed.org. I'm 47, I'm trying to tweet, but nonexposed.org to visit that there are six people in this country who have provided like 95% of their funds, and those six wealthy people are trying to overturn all of our rights in Maryland, and this year potentially our rights in Minnesota and in Washington, because there will be potentially four ballot measures come November. One thing that's very important about what will be on the ballot in Maryland, which is different than Prop 8, it will be specifically a measure to allow same-gender couples to marry. We passed the law, they're trying to repeal it, so we will be the for side in this issue. And probably Washington State will be in the same position, as will Maine. This question has only been on the ballot once before in Maine, two or three years ago, when we very narrowly defeated an effort to allow same-gender couples to marry. So we're going through new territory in Maryland, but when we all sat and we watched those ads that were shown, those are what you're going to see on television, because probably everyone sitting in this room is part of the Washington media market. Oh, by the way, I represent Kensington, Wheaton, Silver Spring, and Chevy Chase. But all of you are going to get to see those commercials on television, and you're going to see that little girl reading King and King, who's one of my colleagues from Anne Arundel County, read King and King on the floor of the state senate, and I had read that book to my children so many times, and if it is as boring as he made it sound, I feel really bad. But it's a cute book, but we're going to hear that story because they're going to put those ads on the television here. We've created an organization much like the Campaign for All DC Families, Marylanders for Marriage Equality. I tried to tweet it. I put the hashtag up for it, which is MD4ME. I hope all of you will, no matter where you are in the area, will go to that website, sign our pledge, and join, because we're going to need to put commercials on that answer those questions. That is about our children. And I have two children. This is what our governor did very effectively during the legislative session. He made it about the children of same-gender couples. And we went head-on that issue of not running away from the children issue, but addressing it head-on and addressing it from the fact that we have children there are gay young people. They deserve the same chance, the same benefits that come with marriage. So I look forward to your questions and comments, and I really appreciate Woolly doing this, and I should say, I really appreciate the work of HRC and NGLTF and Equality of Maryland of helping us get to the point where we are in Maryland, because without those national partners, we wouldn't be there. So, thank you.
Thank you, obviously, to you guys. So let's open it up. I have so many questions, but I want to open it up to the audience here, and then also, like I was saying, on Twitter. So, questions. Questions for the panel. And I think we have somebody with the mic over here. So let's start in the middle over here. We'll take these two guys down. And I'm going to hand the mic.
So first of all, thank you so much for being here to this event. I felt like in watching the play, one of the underlying themes is that the courtroom is a great venue in which we can subject the arguments of same-sex opponents, their arguments to scrutiny across examination. I felt like the play was silent, however, on the ability of these type of efforts to change personal and private opinions. Let's say the type of opinions held by, you know, the people that decided against testifying, or you know, someone that worked on Prop 8, the type of opinions that govern in a secret solitude atmosphere like the ballot box. So I was just curious to hear the opinion of the panel as to what extent do you guys feel like litigative efforts like the Prop 8 trial can change these type of opinions, which may or may not have a basis in rational thought or rational argument?
Well, I think there are two things. One is that there is always that debate, do you change hearts and minds first, or do you change law first? And the reality is that today, or I should say last year, they took a poll in Mississippi, and the majority of residents of Mississippi still believe that interracial marriage was wrong. So if we're going to wait to change hearts and minds, we may wait a long time, even though the polls are changing dramatically. And in the area of marriage equality, the polls are usually 6 to 7 points behind what is actually there. So if you're ahead by about 5 or 6 points in favor, it's most probably about dead even. So I think that what matters and what we did in D.C. and I think what Maryland will be looking to is, first of all, people like the president, who turns around and says, I'm now in favor of gay marriage, giving cover and courage to an incredible amount of people, including the Dublin NAACP, which called marriage now a civil right. So I think what you're looking at is that changing hearts and minds slowly, but nothing will end up doing it as quickly as the court will do it. I think a lot of people are anticipating that the Massachusetts case, actually looking at our Supreme Court today, will get there before the Prop 8 case. Paul Smith, who's counsel on that case, the reality there is potentially that Justice Kennedy can turn around and get rid of Section 3 of DOMA based on states' rights, which is an easier thing potentially for him to do. So I think we're moving there slowly, but everyone here, and everyone you know, part of what the campaign did, part of what I think needs to be done, is coming out, talking to people, talking to everybody you know, and donating a lot of money to the state of Maryland. Because the reality is, we have to equal the kind of money that's going to be spent on the other side if Maryland will win marriage equality. And I think that's every one of us in the room, every friend we know, and everybody out there.
I think, just to go back about litigation as an education, obviously, the Prop 8 trial was a little different than many of the marriage cases we had before because there was an actual trial and there was an examination of the facts and there were witnesses, and most of these cases have been decided on summary judgment, briefs, and then, you know, boom, you have a marriage case. So, but I think two things. First of all, litigants are incredibly powerful spokespeople for this issue, right? These are people who are not just, you know, run-of-the-mill same-sex couple with kids who you see in the, you know, in the grocery store on the corner. These are folks who are getting up in front of, you know, a court, putting their life sort of out there in its entirety for scrutiny, and, you know, and standing up and suing their government, trying to advocate for themselves. So I think the folks that the litigation groups develop as plaintiffs are tremendous spokespeople, and I don't think we can underestimate the importance of those individuals. I do think, despite the best efforts of the proponents of Prop 8, AFER has done a tremendous job of getting every last detail of that trial out into the, I mean, curtailing the ability to broadcast the trial actually just made people all the more interested in what actually happened in that courtroom. And so I think this play and the efforts that they have done to push that out has done, whatever the outcome of the litigation, and I think an immeasurable amount of public education on this issue. And so I wouldn't say that litigation is closed courtrooms and people don't see the reality of what's happening to people.
And I'll just add, I think, part of what we've seen is that courts make decisions in a social and political context. And so changing hearts and minds over a very long period of time, this is not a new issue or new conversations, it actually goes back to the power of what many of us who are LGBT people have experienced in coming out, that we tell our stories. And the power of telling your story to your family, to coworkers, does change hearts and minds and changes the social and political context in which legal decisions are being made. And there are multiple, there's no one silver bullet. If there was, we'd all throw our money in that and we'd be done with it. But so do other things that happen. States where we have achieved marriage equality, that changes people's minds. And I think what we're seeing is, and certainly the president, we've seen a 20 point jump in public opinion, particularly among African Americans, in the last month. If any of our organizations do just nothing on marriage, we get a point a year. We just jumped 20 years in a month. There's a reason that the president felt comfortable, multiple reasons, but among them, to come out publicly is because millions of people across the country have had these conversations with their family members and their friends, and they've changed each other's minds.
Be a bit contrary. I don't believe that courts change minds. I really don't. I think it is a very inside the park, and even people who are well educated don't understand the difference between a district court and a federal court and what the Supreme Court. I just don't believe that courts have that big of a profound impact. They're important. I think legislative processes are important because you'll have hearings. Often they're televised, and you can see your neighbors. And I think in the BC marriage fight, HRC did a fantastic job, as well as Peter's group, of trying to educate people to come and tell their story during their testimony. You have mothers and fathers and friends, and maybe it was fantastic. If I can share just one story that really brings this home, I was in Vermont in March of 2009 when the issue was absolutely right in front. I was in Montpelier when the issue was before the Vermont legislature. This is just a bit of a background. We were there because an organization I chair called the National Legislative Association on Prescription Drug Prices. We were having our annual meeting there. One of our members was then State Senator Pete Shumlin, who's now the governor. And we had a number of other people from New England who were there. I was the chair of the group, and as the chair of the group, I put two things forward to this national organization. One, BC should be a state, and hi, I'm a big fag. And we made none of those terms. But what was interesting was how, they all felt very comfortable because of my advocacy in the organization, my leadership for a long time, to kind of really start pushing, and the subject of marriage was kind of a second tier track to what we were talking about with prescription drugs. So you have Pete Shumlin, as I said, who was the principal mover in Vermont. You had people like Sharon Treat, who was the former majority leader of the Maine Senate, being one of the principal sponsors in the House, and so on and so on. There was one woman who was my vice chair, a woman by the name of Cindy Rosenwald, who's still a representative there, and who was as lovely and as progressive a person as you will ever find over dinner. New Hampshire had voted the week or two before Vermont in favor of marriage equality in their house, and no one thought it would happen. And it was a close vote, and I was talking to Cindy, and I just assumed she had voted for it. I was like, wow, that was a really close vote. I mean, how did we do it? She's like, well, I voted against it. And I was like, what are you talking about, Willis? I mean, what? I mean, I should tell you, like, my background, Cindy had been my friend for many years, and I thought I'd given up the office with respect to Cindy. I'd given her son a paid internship in my office, he met his girlfriend in my office, I got him into law school, and then internship with the Attorney General of the District of Columbia. Raise your hands here if you thought I'd given up the office with the Rosenwald. And I was like, Cindy, what are you talking about? How can you do this? She's like, well, you know, I only think that, you know, change will happen through television. And I was like, where is Cindy Rosenwald, and what have you done with her? You're a smart woman in New York advertising. How are you going to be so crazy? And she said, well, you know, I really believe that. But there was a redeeming point. The story's going to end soon. The redeeming point was when her colleague said, oh, but what you don't understand is that Cindy actually saved marriage. I'm like, what? She had voted on the prevailing side against marriage. Okay, so when more of the Democrats finally arrived into the state house in Concord, you know, they had like 10,000 people in the state legislature, and so a bunch of Democrats finally arrived, and Cindy was the deciding, because she had voted on the prevailing side, she could move the reconsideration, and so Cindy moved the reconsideration, which kept it alive. And the Senate of New Hampshire had hoped and prayed it would die in the House. Had she not moved that reconsideration, there would not have been marriage in New Hampshire. The end of the story is Cindy, after I talked with her, I kind of had that, my profit and loss statement here, girl, you owe me. She became one of the principal champions of marriage equality in New Hampshire and was so pleased to call me and tell me when this year the Republicans tried to reverse it, how they had slammed the door on the subject. The point is, courts don't change. Right? You never know, as Rita said, you never know how media and personal connections and all of these things come into play. All right, long story aside.
Because I wouldn't necessarily disagree with that, but I guess to come back to your question, what struck me about the play is that this trial was, you know, a refracted this social debate in such a clear way through the court proceeding. I mean, a lot of times you think of lawyers and legalese and things, you know, what actually happens in the courtroom for, you know, as lawyers know, isn't often easily understandable or as readily translatable. But that wasn't the case in this trial. I mean, this trial was this fundamental social debate being played out in a courtroom on exactly the terms, I think, in many ways, you know, that it's been reflected throughout our society in the public debate. And I think very many of the arguments that were very compelling in the trial are the kinds of arguments that have been compelling in the public debate, arguments that organizations like HRC have refined in its own marriage equality campaign. If you watch some of the ads that were done in New Yorkers for Marriage Equality, listen to the messages and talk about love and commitment and what's emphasized in these messages because it has been shown to resonate, is exactly what was brought out in this trial. And as I was sitting here watching the play, I had this flashback to my elementary school, when I was in like Sunday school, and they showed, you know, Inherit the Wind, the film, and this is like this kind of like the scoped trial, you know, of the century, right? I mean, this is a trial of the century. It's this incredible contested social issue being fought out in the courtroom in a very compelling and ultimately, as we saw, theatrical way, dramatic way.
There was an article in the New York Times a few weeks ago about gay on TV and how showing gay couples has impacted the public's view through television. And one of the guys who's the co-creator and producer of Modern Family, which is a show that probably many of us in this room watch, he was actually a former news anchor in Madison, Wisconsin, before he got into show business. And he said, you know, the rule of thumb in the newsroom was don't tell the audience that 2 million people are affected by this. Show one of the people affected. And that's what we do on Modern Family. And that's what we have to do in the campaign in Maryland. Because look at that ad. They didn't put about the child being taught in school. They didn't say your children will be taught. They showed a little girl with a book telling that story, and we have to be able to counter that argument in Maryland and in Maine and in Washington with making these same stories. And it's going to take, I'm sorry that we're in the middle of a campaign and I'm making a pitch over and over and over, it's going to take $7 million for us to make that case in the state of Maryland. Governor O'Malley spent $14 million on reelect money. So we're only asking for half of that successful statewide campaign, but that's what it's going to take between the Washington media market and the Baltimore media market and around the rest of the state in order to have our stories up on television to counter that side. Because they're going to have these secret, deep pocket people that are just going to write the checks that happened. It happened in Maine last time, it happened in Prop 8 in California. And if we don't all dig deep or give $10 or whatever in order to make this happen, we're going to suffer a similar defeat in Maryland. Even though the polls show us up right now, the polls show us up, thanks to President Obama, 57-39.
Can't get it off.
That's a huge fly. That is a huge swing. And as far as I'm concerned, the biggest news was now Michelle Obama, who I don't think is a better spokesperson for us in Maryland than to have Michelle Obama on television or in a robocall or in a mailing or hopefully for $7 million in all of those things. Letting people know that she and the president support it. Because having the first lady say, I'm not worried about my children, that's going to be a very powerful message that the other side won't be able to counter.
For some of the, I don't know, and then for others working nationally, I'm just thinking of D.C. and how lucky we were in D.C. to have this human, what's it called, the Human Rights Initiative, or I forget what the exact words are. But, you know, in states like Maryland or other, you know, kind of friendly states out there, is it worth thinking for a push for that so that something like this can't happen again, either for GLBT rights or kind of anybody else?
So I assume you're talking about the provision in the D.C. Charter
that
was used to prevent this issue from being petitioned to referendum.
It's human rights charter. It's not a charter, actually.
But Rich, do you want to answer that? Well, you'll be happy to know that the Maryland State Constitution prohibits two items from the ballot, a budget measure or a measure dealing with alcohol beverages. And I have tried to talk about how same-gender weddings will have a lot of alcohol beverages. But unfortunately, all of my friends in the legal community say that's too tenuous of an argument to try to make, because I really keep the HRC legal department busy coming up with different ideas to do just that. So, yes, are we going to be aggressive at trying to make sure that they didn't fraudulently get the signatures? Yes. Are we going to be aggressive to say you can't hide your contributions like you are funneling and laundering them through NOM? The people who paid for the petition drive, the Maryland Marriage Alliance, guess who their biggest donor was? The Maryland Marriage Alliance. I don't quite get how you give yourself a lot of money and that somehow passes legal muster, but we're going to be fighting. But unfortunately, we don't have that same provision, and I don't know if that's ever going to come about in Maryland. But if we had started 20 years ago with the thought, yes, we would have added that to our constitution.
So actually, the district human rights ordinance, there is a limitation on initiatives and referendums in the district that applies only to budget items. The council, as part of its the Human Rights Act, had a human rights ordinance that prohibits initiatives and referendums. So it isn't in the organic Home Rule Charter. It was a council edition in the 1970s. And so that was the subject of Bishop Jackson's first of many assaults on the city by trying to essentially say the council was not authorized, duly authorized, to have that. Okay? And so that decision was the first of the many lawsuits was settled in the summer of 2009. And the decision was written by the Superior Judge Judith Rechen. And I had the privilege of having lunch with Judge Rechen. I had not met with her, had no discussions with her, but I had the privilege of being at a party of six. Two of my best friends got married after 35 years together. Actually, it was only five because I didn't have a date. But I was there with them and Judge Rechen and her partner. And so, you know, it's so fascinating how these, we had a discussion about how she went to the chief judge about should she recuse herself. And she was instructed that she should not. And so you never know how these kind of things fall into place, you know? It's interesting.
as we're seeing more judges come out, it's very interesting that some of these cases are coming before judges that are gay or lesbian. But one of the things in the trial that moves people forward, there was a discussion about the reparative therapy. And only 2 weeks ago, Dr. Robert Spitzer apologized to the gay community. At the same time, the World Health Organization came out and said that reparative therapy is dangerous to people. And Dr. Spitzer, who did the study in 1999, apologized for the bogus study that people like Marcus Bachmann and others have used to make money on reparative therapy. So I think we're moving so quickly in a lot of different areas, and the hearts and minds of people are changing, but it is a process.
Can I say Bishop Jackson has moved back to Maryland?
Right?
So, so I don't know, he's like standing in the doorway. It's quite a funny picture with the signature. So this is the sort of the game. So if you follow this issue in the city with Bishop Jackson, who's the voice there, he's now back in Maryland to lead the similar effort.
I think I want to go right back here. There's a woman at the very back with her hand up. I'm sorry. Let's see who's back here. Right here, yeah, let's do it here, right here.
That's you.
Yeah, sorry.
So how long will it be before this play is available for amateur productions?
So we ended up being contacted by Broadway Impact, and the play is available for amateur productions, and it's being performed all around. I mean, performed in various degrees. Sometimes stage readings, like you saw tonight, and sometimes more full productions. But it's being licensed by Broadway Impact, which is really wonderful. Totally for free. So we are. It was just a wonderful opportunity for us to get this out here and have a conversation about all of these issues.
I can tell you on July 22nd at the Annapolis Unitarian Church, a community theater group called Dignity Players is going to be doing Eight. So it is getting out. The only downside is they won't let you use it for a fundraiser.
Right.
For anyone, but I think that Americans, you know, whatever the group they're from, the American Foundation for Equal Rights. But it's going to be shown, it's going to be talked about all over Maryland. And I think it is available on YouTube videos, right? I think the whole thing has been.
Yeah, the really scarred video is available on YouTube. So let's see, let's move forward down here.
I was struck in the play tonight, and I am elsewhere, that I think there's a certain sloppiness of language when we say gay marriage or marriage equality, because we're really just talking about marriage in City Hall, not in churches. We should say gay civil marriage or civil marriage equality, and that term is almost never used, all the way from many articles in the Washington Post to these plays to everywhere else. And I think it lets the religious right run wild when we don't emphasize our separation of church and state. I know it's a lot harder to say gay civil marriage or civil marriage equality, but I'm just wondering if any of you have any thoughts, because I worry about these 49-51 elections, or like the 2010 congressional elections, and I know it's going to be coming up in this next election. They'll try to link the two, so I'm wondering if the word civil shouldn't be said all the time in these things. A little tougher, but it's linguistically important.
There have actually been a series of conversations that I won't walk you through about this very matter, and so I'm glad you raised it, but I mean, we, over the course of many years, have changed how we've talked about marriage. We now say marriage. Sometimes we'll say marriage equality, but often we're just saying marriage because, Evan Wolfson, who's played in the play, makes this point frequently, which it's marriage. There's nothing else in this country that is marriage except marriage. And I think part of what we have done, certainly when we have occasion or need to do so, is to say, that it is a civil marriage. This is something that's done by the state in this country, and people can choose to do that or not with their religious institutions. I think the other thing that we've done, to your point of language, is that we've really moved over a course of years away from what used to be a very rights-focused language. We focus on these 1,300 plus rights, and we start talking about these rights, which, as it turns out, opposite-sex couples didn't even realize that was an issue. because they got married because they love each other. They want to have families together. So we've moved significantly to language around really the humanity and the human experience. And I loved, in fact, what Dustin did in the play, where we kind of go back and forth with this family having a very typical, mundane, yet meaningful conversation about whether they're going to get takeout or not. And so I think the more that we can get to how people experience marriage and love and family, the closer we get and the more we resonate with people, say, well, of course they should be able to get married. It's marriage.
In fact, in Maryland, the bill that we passed is the Civil Marriage Protection Act. So we tried to put in the word civil marriage. It used to have the word religious and civil marriage protection act, to try to separate the religious aspect out. But in the end, what passed was the Civil Marriage Protection Act. As I try to say to people all the time, doesn't everyone want a gay wedding? Or a gay marriage? That's what we all hope.
I think we only have time for maybe a couple more questions, and I want to definitely get to this side of the house as well. So let's start over here, and then there's somebody at the very back of the house over there as well. So we'll start here, and then we'll go to the back of the house up there.
So I know a lot of you have said on stage right now that you're openly gay, and that I don't know about the rest of you because I'm 14 and I'm not really involved in that much. But I was just wondering, like, overall, how important you think it is to just make sure that everybody knows that not everybody who's involved in gay rights or just at a very basic level civil rights isn't necessarily gay or part of the LGBTQ community, because like there was this line in the play where he's driving up and this woman has this bumper sticker that's it's about voting yes on Prop 8, and she's like, your kind doesn't deserve marriage or something like that, and she just automatically assumes that because he supports gay marriage, he's gay, and he was in the play, but not everybody is, and I think that's a really strong message to send out, and I was wondering kind of what was happening to send out.
Well, I think, you know, it's definitely an effort of you know, for all the organizations to engage, you know, the broader community and support for what we're working on. I mean, someone mentioned the New York Museum of Equality videos, I think, too. But, I mean, we've HRC, for example, has been engaging in a sort of a video campaign, getting prominent folks to speak out about their support for marriage equality. Almost universally, you know, non-LGBT people who are nonetheless supportive of marriage and from a broad range of, you know, racial and ethnic backgrounds, you know, different professions, involvement in the mainstream civil rights community. So certainly there's that public education effort. And then you've just seen recently, you know, the NAACP, for instance, just passed a resolution in support of marriage equality. So, and not certainly without lobbying from LGBT groups, you know, not just sort of spontaneously, you know, we should get on board with that, but, you know, like, you know, a conscientious effort by organizations, national and local, to engage, you know, allies of all kinds, and make sure that you're absolutely right, that this is communicated as a message of support across the board for marriage equality, that it's not just an LGBT issue, and that the support for this is not, you know, confined to just the community that's going to directly impact.
Yeah, I think it's safe to say that some of the incredible watershed moments in this debate have occurred when, you know, straight allies have come out in support of marriage equality. I mean, the fact that, you know, when Ted Olson and David Boies joined forces, I mean, that was an unbelievable, you know, man bites dog moment in this debate. I mean, and, you know, and I think the numbers began to change overnight because Ted Olson was identified as, you know, this Republican lawyer who argued Bush v. Gore, and here he is arguing for, you know, marriage in the Prop 8 case, and obviously when President Obama announced his support, and, you know, if you look at the HRC campaign, I mean, the most compelling videos are, you know, when you have, you know, like Sean Avery, you know, a professional hockey player, a professional basketball player, a professional baseball player, you know, people you wouldn't expect. And these, and when they stand up and say, you know, they support our community, I mean, that has an incredibly powerful, you know, resonant effect.
If any of you go to the website Mariners for Marriage Equality, you will see videos, just like in New York, you will see videos from a range of people, from one of the star defensive linemen for the Baltimore Ravens did a video. Monique, the actress, did a video. Governor O'Malley did a video. The head of the Maryland AFL-CIO, is an African-American man, has a new video up with his openly gay son, talking about all of his children and his love for all of his children. It's a very powerful video, but we're trying to do the same thing. And if any of you are really close with Cal Ripken and can convince him to do it, I think that would be really helpful. So but those things do move individuals, and we're doing that in Maryland. And anything you can do, if you went to the website and then shared those videos, a lot of people saw them in New York, but to share those same videos, because HRC has been very generous in helping us do that same sort of campaign, but we gotta get the word out throughout the region and throughout the country.
And if you're on Facebook, some of the most moving videos are the ones of the children of gay couples who are speaking out. The young man who just wrote the book,
Zach Walls,
and others. I mean, you can't help but be moved when you hear that. And one of the most interesting things is using the children against marriage equality and saying it's terrible for the children, when the recognition is this is changing generationally. And when enough older people, I'm old, die off, people are going to look back and say, oh my God, what was all this about? And it's generational, and you're not protecting children from this, you're educating children. And I think if we figure out how to do that and how to bring that out there, yes, in D.C., we were very careful to make sure that straight individuals, diversity of individuals, testified in the council, went out and talked to people. But I think we're seeing that happen, and I think it's crucial that we bring more and more young people out. And in Maryland, that you use all the universities that are there and bring those young people out and talk to people. That's going to make a difference.
Great, so let's take two last questions, one right up here and then the last one right down here, okay?
Thank you. I think my question has been answered in part, but maybe there's more to say. I was really struck by the 20-point bump in African-American support. I'm an ally, I'm an African-American, and that just really makes me feel great. I hope that will continue. And I was wondering if you've noticed other trends or shifts along other demographic lines and how, if and how that affects your advocacy work?
Some of it we have talked about, but I mean, certainly, and I think the 20%, I haven't kind of looked underneath it to see what all the factors are. I think that people of a variety of races and ethnicities, after the president and after NAACP came out in support, were in some ways kind of given permission to be public about something they already believed. And then others said, oh, well, he's finer than I can be finer. So I think we need to learn more about that. Certainly the younger demographic shift, is my position, though, that we should not wait and just wait for what some call the attrition strategy. because we don't need to wait that long, and we shouldn't. This should not be our children's fight. And I do think, I mean, there are other Latina women in some circumstances have been very supportive, higher than other demographics. So we're seeing it in different areas. When we looked back at Prop 8, as a matter of fact, unfortunately, immediately, there was a lot of blame game going on about who lost the election, and it was horrible what came out immediately based on no data whatsoever about African-American voters. What that was really about, Prop 8, was a high religiosity across a variety of voters. And so we have had to work to actually dispel some of the myths that got perpetuated through Prop 8 and some of the other campaigns that happened that year. So I think we're going to continue to see this. It'll be interesting as we head into the fall, and we've got the likely four ballot measures that are very different from each other. In some ways, we've got Maryland and Washington likely defending marriage that already exists. We've got Maine historically proactively putting a ballot measure forward, and then defending, fighting off an attack in Minnesota. I think we're going to learn a lot about people of faith We are running, actually, and have done a lot of the groundwork in Maryland around people of faith, progressive people of faith, and in Minnesota, where we are doing a very intentional grassroots organizing campaign for progressive people of faith. That is something that we have not been able to do in many other campaigns before, and I think we'll learn a lot about it and how that shifts.
Can I say, in Maryland, the subgroups, that African-American numbers from before the president's announcement and after the president's announcement, we just happened to have a poll hit 2 days after the president made his announcement, and it was a 20-point swing in the African-American community, where we went from like being down 39-56 to being up 56-39, and that moved the overall numbers in Maryland from 52 to 57 in support. So it's a huge shift. If you just look at the vote in North Carolina, the five largest cities in North Carolina that are majority African American all voted against the constitutional amendments in North Carolina. What you were saying is absolutely the case. It's a urban-rural divide, and it's a religious divide. And we're fortunate in Maryland, you all know Maryland, it is a highly urban state. About 80% or more of the population live in the two metro areas. So it's a very different vote than you've had in many other states because of the highly concentrated nature of the two large metropolitan, and I would like to say, educated and sophisticated areas of the state of Maryland. Unlike Virginia.
I do think it's important to approach these like political campaigns. And so one of the things we were able to do with the district, in part with HRC support, was to actually poll in advance so we would know where we stood within the various populations. And so religiosity is a big deal. You know, the more likely you are to be Baptist, the more likely you are to be against. The more likely you are, the more observant you are as a Baptist, the more likely you are to be against. And then education. So it's religiosity, it's religion, and it's education. So for instance, in our polling, we found that college-educated or above African-Americans were in support of marriage equality of those who were not. But the same was true for Caucasians. There just happened to be fewer high school educated or below Caucasians in the district. You know, Peter's group did a fantastic job of getting, you know, the religious community out front on this. So we actually had about 200 members of faith. So we had more members of faith and religiously leaders testify in support of marriage equality than against. But here's why I think it's so important, depending on, you know, this is kind of the answer to your question, why is it important? It is important to have non-LGBTQ members in the forefront. But sometimes, you know, we have to be there, right? In this discussion, we use these lines, we use them many, many times, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu, right? So it was critically important to me when I was battling with the Archdiocese that I knew the numbers as it related to Catholics. I knew the Catholics were the most pro-equality Christian denomination in the district, and that non-observant Catholics were off the charts in favor of marriage equality. And so when the chancellor of the archdiocese came and tried to do a soprano moment on me and basically say, you know, we've been rather measured, you have not seen us take some of the stands that, for instance, the Baptist ministers have taken, and I responded, I said, I'm assuming you've seen the same polling I have, and if you do it, you'll have riots in your pews, so don't threaten me, okay? You have to know where you stand, and you have to, when you know the areas and the groups that you are in trouble with, you've got to find the people who can speak to that crowd. And candidly, if you can get Michelle Obama to do a piece in Maryland, the election is over. I don't know if it'll cost $1 million, but you can get that. Legit, you guys can win.
And you're going to see the Catholic Church, in fact, is going to be doing their national Restore the Faith, Restore Our Freedom. They're having this national event that starts in Baltimore with a sermon in Baltimore and ends with a sermon in Washington to feature the Archbishop of Baltimore and the Archbishop of Washington talking about how, you know, the contraception and marriage and all these things are an attack on the Catholic faith. And so they're going to put a lot of effort into Maryland, even though the polling numbers show, just like in the district,
Catholics are very strongly in support of marriage equality. So there's a great quote from someone, from a minister recently in Maryland, who said, the clergy, just like they often talk about the stock market as a lagging indicator of the economy, clergy are lagging indicators of what's happening in the pews. And I think you see in a lot of places this is changing, and the clergy are starting to understand that the flock is in a very different position.
Last question, right down here.
Thanks. I want to thank you all for giving us your wisdom and your thoughts and your experience, and great props to Woolly for putting on this reading. Now, I want to address as quickly as I can. I have 50,000 thoughts running through my head. But it strikes me that a number of you on the panel were saying that it's very important for people to hear the personal, which is what this stage reading gave us, and what the play itself, if it were fully staged, would certainly do. And I'm thinking how important it was in the past for angels in America to change people's ideas about AIDS and about people who are living as closeted gays and the difficulty in coming out or not coming out. And then, of course, Laramie in, again, personalizing the situation so it's not just a news item or legalism. And I think the fact that this play, when it was announced by Woolly, sold out within, what, 3-4 hours? I was too late, and I got in only by the grace of the box office, which gave me a ticket that somebody else couldn't use. And I wanted to ask the Senator, Madaleno, will this be produced in Maryland, this play? I followed all the discussion about Prop 8, but this play gave me information that I was not aware of, and in particular, the testimony of people who were living the life and who were able to speak with an authority that struck to the heart when legal arguments alone couldn't carry that force. So I challenge everybody on the stage, get this play out. I challenge Woolly to consider doing a fully staged version of this, maybe next year or the year after. Because even if Prop 8 is decided in the way we all want it to be, there will be other fights going on in all the states. And the only way that the opposition is able to mount their effective story is to try to suppress the knowledge of what is going on, to suppress the personal stories. So I ask you specifically, will this be done in Maryland? And if not, I would urge you to consider whatever you could to help that happen.
July 22nd, Dignity Players at the Annapolis Unitarian Congregation. This will be put on. I'd be great if John would reach out to the Groundhouse in Bethesda, or Center Stage, or one of the multitude.
Baltimore, to
do it. Minnesota, there's a very interesting group in Minnesota called Minnesota Artists for Equality, which has come together to fight the constitutional amendment. Working with people right now to try to create Maryland Artists for Equality, because it's all about artists donating not just their name, but their time, their talent to help get the message out, recognizing that there are so many people out there who can help in producing videos to put out, who can help with productions, who can help with art, and try to make it happen. So I think those things are going to happen across the state. And to reiterate, all of this is on YouTube. And you know, unlike some of the other things, you can share all these stories. We can all go home tonight and look up that ending, that closing argument from Ted Olson, and put that clip on your Facebook page or tweet it, and let people know that it's out there and experience that culminating moment.
And that is wonderful, but I'll say nothing beats the shared experience of being in the theater, hearing the people. And thanks to Woolly.
Okay, Well, need to wrap it up. I just want to thank several people really quickly before we get out of here. I just want to thank Gibson, Diamond, and Crusher for supporting tonight and for making tonight possible. Broadway Impact, of course, our director, Alan Hall, over at Shakespeare, who did such a wonderful job with the reading itself. Our wonderful cast of 22 plus amazing actors from all over DC who gave us their time today to put this on. And of course, all of our panelists for everything that they have contributed tonight in sort of educating us. So thank you all, and thank you to everybody who helped make tonight possible. And thank you for joining us.
John?
Yes?
Do you mind if I take a moment to plug Lonely Planets?
Sure.
Thank you so much. I just wanted to take an opportunity to talk to this hyper-targeted audience of supporters, because we are doing a show called Lonely Planets with two Woolly Company members, myself and Michael Rosato, and directed by John Breakey, who is another Woolly Company member, so this is also an appropriate audience for that reason. And it's a play that's set in the backdrop of the 1980s AIDS crisis, and it's a beautiful story about friendship, really. But many of the themes from tonight's show and from tonight's discussion are echoed in the play, in the razor-sharp and poignant dialogue of Stephen Dietz. And I would love to encourage everyone to come check us out. We've had a hard time getting people out to Metro Stage in Alexandria. But like we were talking about, I know David was mentioning the power of the theater to sort of change minds and just continue the conversation. And we've had like days with six people in the house. So anybody you could tell about the show, or if you could come yourself, we would really love to have you. Again, it's called Lonely Planets, and it's at Metro Stage. You can just visit metrostage.org for more info.
And I can say I saw it, and I'm not a plant. And that man was great, and Michael was great, and it's an extraordinary play. Very moving.
Thank you all so much.
Have a great day.